Let's take our Bibles and wave them around in the air a little bit and say, this is my Bible. I can be what it says I can be. I can do what it says I can do. And I can have what it says I can have. My mind is alert and my spirit is receptive to the living word of God in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn to two or three people around you here this morning and say, hey, you're looking good. Amen. This is week number four as I talk more all about love, covering aspects of love that we've never covered before in all the different love series that I've done. And today I want to show you that perfect love is a highly developed skill, and it's an art. And in fact, perfect love is the art of negotiation. You've heard of the art of the deal by some famous people out there, and the art of negotiation. It's not a new one, it's a Bible one. The Bible talks about negotiating. The Bible, the Old Testament, and the New Testament talk about how to make a deal. Make a deal with people. Of course, we're using different terminology, Bible terminology, but we're going to cover that here this morning. Let's go over to Matthew chapter 5, Matthew 5. We're going to start up there today, and I'm going to pray. Dear Father Yahweh Elohim, we invoke your name once again over all your people here today, over this service and over the way and with the force and the power and the direction that I deliver it. Father, have your Holy Spirit direct me with my words and my thoughts and my actions to teach your people your way, to teach your people your love and how we should deal with one another. Father, have it be your will and not my will and not any man's will. And Father God, I ask for protection over every mind and over every heart here from the enemy to have any part of this word stolen from them or removed from them both now or into the future when they hear comments about it or it's discussed at any point. Both for those here, those watching live, those that are going to see this on TV, those that will be seeing this in any other format, in any of our stations, in Jesus' mighty name, and all God's people said, amen, amen and amen and amen. All right. Now, Matthew chapter 5, many of you know this is called the Sermon on the Mount section of your Bible. And I'm going to start up in verse 21. You have heard that the ancients were told, you shall not commit murder, and whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court. But I say to you, everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty to the court. And whoever says to his brother, you good for nothing, or raka, shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. And whoever says you fool shall be guilty enough to go into fiery hell or Gehenna. Therefore, if you are presenting your offering at the altar and there is something you remember that your brother has something against you, leave your offering there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and present your offering. So Jesus is talking about here about murder. He brings up murder first and he brings it up that it's in the Ten Commandments. So we're going to look at this morning a testing of your heart. I read this a lot. I know a lot of people read this a lot. But when the Holy Spirit gave me this message, I thought, oh my goodness, I preached some difficult messages before. And I think this is going to be a difficult one, not because of my delivery so much as because of what God is requiring out of us as Christians and as human beings. And so I think that we're going to be tested here this morning to see if we can really truly follow the words of Jesus and what he's asking us to do, and actually what he's requiring us to do. Now, the first thing that we see happening here, let's do a little bit of a Bible study. In verse 21, you have heard it said, the ancients were told, you shall not commit murder. Now, many of your Bibles will have this in caps and showing that this is part of the Old Testament. He's rephrasing it out, the Old Testament, you shall not commit murder. And we know that that came from the Ten Commandments that was given to Moses, that Moses presented to the people. However, if you recall back several years ago when I was doing a study of the history of the world, going all the way back to creation, and then the time of creation up to the time of the flood, what I'll call creation year 1556, we found out that there was actually seven commandments already in the earth. They're called the Noahide laws today, but there was already seven commandments in the earth, and one of them was you weren't supposed to murder your brother, which is what Cain did to Abel. And that's why Cain needed a safety city, or what was called a blood city, to go to, to run to. so that no one would kill him. And in fact, God put a mark on his forehead so that he wouldn't be killed in retribution for the murder that he committed. But murder is wrong, and that was established right away, right? And we see right away in the beginning of Genesis. So these rules are not brand new rules, and not really brand new with Moses. But he's saying here, when we finally got this written down on two stone tablets, this was one of them. It was commandment number 6. And he said, you shall not commit murder, and whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court. So he's given us some wisdom and some head knowledge, things that everyone already knows. And then he goes on to verse 22 and he says this, but I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. So the same court that's dealing with the murder is going to be the same court that someone who is angry with their brother is going to have to now appear before. The same judges, the same court with the same rules. And he's saying there is a greater rule going on here. And look what he says here. And whoever says to his brother, you good for nothing, or raka, which is, some believe it's a Aramaic term. It's actually a Hebrew term that is used also in Aramaic. You good for nothing, or raka, shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. Or good for nothing is really not what it means in the Hebrew and in the Aramaic. Actually, it means you empty head. And it means you ain't got nothing in your head. You were born without a brain. If you know you stuck a pencil in one ear, there'd be no obstruction to pull it out from the other ear. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You empty head. You shall be guilty before the Supreme Court, and whoever says you fool shall be guilty enough to go into fiery hell. Now, when we look at that verse, we're finding out that by extension, we're finding out that name-calling on a level that is bitter and is said from the guile of a person's heart when they're angry, even if it's just for a moment, or they're bitter, if bitter things come out of your mouth, that by extension, this is murder from the heart, or murder of the heart. In fact, if you think about this, and I know that I have, how many times have you thought about not extinguishing the life of someone else, but thinking that it would be okay for someone to die, like right about now. It'd just be okay if something happened to them. I know that I thought things like that, and I know other people have. Maybe not any of you here, because you're really perfect. You got good teachers. But I thought that thing. And I can tell you that if it's done in the wrong motive, and most of the time it is, if it's done with the wrong motive, you have to get rid of that. Otherwise, that can take over your heart. So Jesus is saying this. He's saying that the words that are coming out of your mouth, saying empty head or good for nothing or fool, is words that are coming from the heart. And many times, words that come from the heart end up getting translated eventually into actions, into murder or into other actions. Now, anytime that you're rash about accusing people of things or getting angry at people, that rashness is what I call heart murder. I have not seen the type of rashness as I'm seeing out of people today in all my life. More and more now, we watch movies on TV and we have video games where you're playing video games and you're stealing cars and you're killing people and you're shooting up, and it's not just war games, it's different types of things that really plant seeds in people's minds. And the seeds that were being planted back 15 years ago with these video games, these people now are 35 years old with children at home. And so this is something that now is changing generations as we're going through these generations. People are changing. They're not getting good information. They're getting bad information. They're translating that information into what they think is truth when it's really not truth. And so whenever you have rashness in your heart, you're creating heart murder. Now, watch this. Anger is a part of man's nature. It is natural to be angry. God gets angry. The Holy Spirit can be grieved. God has emotions that really were put into mankind, and we have the same emotions as God has, with this one difference. Many times, because of our human nature, those emotions can overtake us and take us out of God's will. So we can be angry and be angry over the right thing. We can have righteous anger. We can be angry at our children for doing the wrong things. We can have righteous anger towards our spouse because they've offended us or they did something, and we rise up and we say, this has got to be settled. But there is a lot of anger, which is heart anger, which is really heart murder, because by extension now we meditate on it and we think about it, and we don't even consider whether it's right or wrong. We don't want to consider whether it's right or wrong. And we then begin to proceed to say things either about our brothers or our sisters or our neighbors without any thought about how this is being viewed from heaven. And God is giving us a word here. Jesus is speaking to us and he's saying, when you begin to go into this area of fury of anger and you begin to speak things out in anger, now you are as guilty as the man who committed an act of murder. Because if you didn't know about the law of murder, that you weren't supposed to murder, if you weren't in a church that talked about it and brought it up, you'd have less restrictions on you personally to carry it out. Yet because we're sitting in a Christian nation and we have rules and laws that are really based on the Ten Commandments, if you commit the majority of the Ten Commandments, I know some of them being broken down, but the majority of the Ten Commandments, you can still be brought into court. Even divorce, you can be brought into court over. And so if you steal, you're going to be brought into court. If you get caught, if you murder and get caught, you're going to be brought into court. Right? So all these things have emanated from the Ten Commandments, or what we call the rule of life, or the rule of heaven. And Jesus is saying this same rule of heaven that is against murder is also against heart murder. And heart murder is any time that you think ill of your brother and think in a way that's either rash or, well, I'll call vile, but I'll give some more better definitions as I go here this morning. So anger is a mortal passion, and sometimes it is necessary and lawful. Now, when I read this, I read this also in the King James, and one of the Bible verses that I memorized the most years ago were out of the King James Bible. So in verse 23, it says this, therefore, if you are presenting your offering at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, or your brother has an ought against you. Well, I had to go and look that up, so I had to go to the Greek. And when I looked up that word ought, and it says that ought in the King James and a few other interpretations, if your brother has an ought against you, the word ought there, having an ought, is a tis, or t, as it's pronounced in the Greek. And then the ought itself is echo. And I just played with this for a while. You never hear of someone doing a tisk, tisk. The monopoeia, you know, is something that's so small yet gets everyone's attention when someone goes tisk, tisk. And then, but it's a tisk, tisk that echoes. In other words, it's a disapproving attitude that is repeated in your mind over and over again, two Greek words, two English words, producing an incredible thought and sound, tisk, tisk, echoing over and over. I wish they wouldn't do that. I don't like the fact that they did that. I don't think that, and that echoes over and over where it feeds on your brain. So, since we are all of one blood, we all came from Adam. We're all human beings, whether we're brothers in church or not. Anger is wrong if it follows this thing, if it's done for no good or if it has an end that is evil. Sometimes people are angry simply to control other people. Sometimes people are angry to get other people to back down. Sometimes people are angry just because they can get away with it. They're just bigger physically. So it might be a size bully issue, or it might be that I'm angry with someone and I just kind of want to spread things that are going to be painful because I can get away with it. I can be a bully because I control a bigger social sphere of people, of groupings of people, and I can sway people against that one individual. I can sway people against the pastor. I can sway people against my husband or my wife. People will use words to destroy other people when they have the ability to get away with it. Anger is in the wrong when it's done for revenge. Many people just want revenge on someone else. They just want revenge. I mean, they got offended, so they want revenge. They were hurt, they want revenge. They saw this person beginning to prosper, so they got revenge. I have seen this over and over again. I've seen so many Christian, I know Christian women do it, but I've been in so many of these men's groups. I've seen Christian men doing it to other Christian men. The moment one Christian man begins to get prophecies, the one moment when one Christian man begins to prosper and everyone else is kind of staying the same, everyone gets offended at that one guy and trying to hold him back, trying to keep him down. And so it is a revenge out of being hurt that God isn't speaking through them. Or God isn't giving them prosperity the way that this one individual might be getting it. Or, you know, they get an inheritance, or they get a windfall of some kind, or someone comes to them and says, you know, we want to buy your property and pay you twice what it's worth. And everyone gets upset because they're jealous. It's revenge out of jealousy. And that's anger done wrong. And how do people express that? They express it with words. They say things. How about this? And I see a lot of this. How about people that are angry because they just want to gratify their abusive nature? Some people are just abusive people. When I was a child, I remember one of my neighbor friends who was my age. We were about 12 years old, and we were in his mother's car. She was driving us to the store, and she was a very abusive person. I recognize that. She was just abusive all the time to everyone, and she was abusive to her son. She wouldn't be abusive to me because I didn't know any better. I would just debate her. But she was abusive to people. I remember she had this old DeSoto, you know, like a 59 DeSoto, for those of you who remember that, and she used to pull games on people and act like it drove great. But she used to play games on people and act like it wasn't driving well when she was pulling into driveways and stuff. And she would pull in front of the traffic, and it was a clutch, and she would kind of clutch it and stall it and just have fun seeing if they would get angry while she was blocking them in the road. She was abusive. And when I used to watch her do this, I think, oh my goodness, this woman is out of control. She's stalling the car in the middle of the road just to get the guy who's coming at her angry. It didn't matter whether it was in the neighborhood or at the grocery store. People are abusive, and people have a habit of just being abusive. And sometimes they'll take that abusive spirit and they'll use anger because they want to gratify that abusive spirit. And they're in church, and they're church people, and they talk so nice until they come to a particular subject or a particular person. Some people have anger that's in the wrong because they just want to hurt people. They're hurt, and everyone else is feeling good, so they snap and they just want to hurt other people. I'm hurting, so if everyone around me is not hurting, we got to change this environment. And so because they're hurting, they begin to get angry and they say things and they do things, but particularly say things. It's the talking that Jesus is referring to here. Amen? So, all these people would kill if they could, if they had the courage to kill, if they knew that they wouldn't get caught, or knew that God would overlook it, or they could just get some grace to cover it. They would kill because their words are already killing. You know what the most killing words are, particularly to church people? Are words that attack the spiritual condition of the person they're victimizing. And so anytime that someone abuses the ability to speak and takes it and aims it at the core of their nature, their spirituality, their walking in Christ, their growth in God, anytime that someone attacks it, well, I don't think that they're all that spiritual. Well, I don't think they hear from God. It could be something just as easy as that, but it could be something that's more subtle, because when you say it, it takes a while to eat away at the what we'll call the armor of that individual. You might hear it first, and then later on, you know, you see them kicking the tires on their car out in the church parking lot and getting angry and, you know, saying something about their car as a lemon and go, I knew that they weren't that spiritual. And so-and-so, they must have been right about that. I said, look at them now. They're angry at their car. And then they go around, they begin to spread that thing that they heard. So, you know, I don't think so-and-so is all that spiritual. Did you see them kicking their car? And they're not even the ones that started it. It was someone else that started that thing. You know, the title of my message today is to reconcile with your neighbor. And so many times when we're doing these things, what we're doing is we're getting outside of the will with our neighbor, and we're doing things outside of God's will for our neighbors and our friends, maybe even our family members. You know, it's one thing to be angry and warn other people about some people that are truly evil. It's also fine just to come out and say, you know, that person acts foolish all the time. You're not going to hang around them. So Jesus is not saying you can't use the term foolish. Jesus is not saying that you can't even be angry. But he's saying that there is a way to be angry, and there are controls and limits that need to be put on the way that you operate in that anger. Now, let's keep reading. By the way, in verse 22, and some of you will see the word Gehenna there. Gehenna is actually a garbage dump just a little bit south of Jerusalem. It was there in Jesus' day, and it was always burning, and it's still there today, just a little bit south of Jerusalem. It's still a garbage dump, and it's always burning. Right now, they're always burying stuff, but there's always a fire going in there. And he said, anyone who shall be guilty enough shall be go into Gehenna, which means to go into hell, to fiery hell. So that it's a translation, but it's actually a place, a location that exists. And hell is a place and a location that exists. And so Jesus has given us a shadow and a type. And he said, if you do these things, this is as bad as murder. Now, I told you, you were going to be tested today. And this is going to try your heart. Now, this is a hard message, not because of the way I'm preaching it, but because if we pay attention to this, there is in every single one of us some correcting that needs to be done. We all need to be corrected in this area. Some of you more than others. Verse 23, therefore, if you are presenting your offering at the altar. Now, anytime you see a therefore, you have to go back and find out what it's there for. All right, so this is a continuation of the same thought. Therefore, if you are presenting your offering at the altar and there remember that your brother has an ought or something against you, leave your offering there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and present your offering, or be reconciled to your neighbor. Now, this is an interesting topic because a lot of people think that Christian actions or Christian behavior is the ultimate value before God. But we know that over in 1 Samuel chapter 15, that Samuel the prophet comes to King Saul and said, it is better to obey than to sacrifice. And so we see a continuation of that now in Jesus' dialogue here as he's given these examples, because King Saul said, well, I'm going to have these big sacrifices with these animals that I kept that I wasn't supposed to keep, but I'm intending good to come of it. And Jesus is saying the same thing here. If you intend good to come of your offering, yet you realize your brother has an ought against you. And this ought against you is a tisk, tisk, echo. It's echoing over and over again. You've offended that individual with words. That you're to go and reconcile with your brother. In other words, go to them and apologize. How many people know how to do that today? I had to write this down. You want to hear what the Holy Spirit gave me late last night? Watch this now. If I forgive you, you've learned nothing, but I've gained prayer power. If I forgive you, you've learned nothing, you've gained nothing, I've gotten everything. That's okay. But it's not good enough. If you do not reconcile, you've learned nothing yourself. And again, you might have the ability to learn something if you were to reconcile. Now, I'm going to show you something. All reconciliation is an act of humility. But it's a humiliating that brings about change. Because many of you need to humble yourselves and humiliate yourself so that you won't say that thing again. You won't participate in that conversation again. You won't go off with those people again and talk smack about, you know, sometimes people go out and they have dinner together and it's nothing but a burn the house down of the person they're talking about. And if it's about the pastor, it's called lunch and roast pastor for lunch. If it's about someone in the church, it's burn their house down, roast them for lunch. And I don't know why people do that. And if you keep doing it often enough, see, we live in communities today where just like back in Jesus' day, it eventually comes back to the the person that you were talking smack. It's eventually going to get back to them. You better herd that thing off now. And reconciliation is this. Reconciliation says, oops, I made a mistake. It may not have been in purpose. You may not have instigated the mistake, but you initiated a mistake. Sometimes a mistake is this. Men, you know, you want to climb the ladder, you know, you're doing good. Your boss offers you a job. The hours change and change. It's going to change the way things operate at home. And you accept the offer without talking to your spouse. Ladies, the same thing. Kathy and I were watching something last night and for a little bit. And this woman gave up her two children and her husband to be an international scientist. Widely acclaimed when she was still in her 20s. Today she's in her early 80s and she's still widely acclaimed. And she doesn't have anything to say about her two children or her husband that she left repeatedly behind. She thought it was more important to climb what we'll call the scientific ladder in the world because she was brilliant. But she had to leave her family. Sometimes people make decisions and then the husband and the children have an ought against mom. Sometimes we make decisions that's bad for the family. Sometimes we make decisions and we didn't think it through. We bought something we shouldn't have bought. We signed papers on a loan to something we shouldn't. We should have gotten more involvement from our spouse. We said, yeah, you can come over, when our spouse or our kids didn't want them over ever. We made decisions without, and then now we create and we create an offense. And that offense now becomes an ought, a tisk, tisk, echo. And that person has that against us. And you can say, well, they need to forgive me. They're a Christian. But what have you learned if you don't repent? And it's not just a repentance, it's a humiliation through apologizing. In business, I know most businessmen I know, most people that have a lot of, whether they're business people, business owners, or they are on the front lines of someone else's company and they are dealing with customers day in and day out, for them this is easy. Apologizing is easy because they got to do it to customers whether they're right or wrong. Customer's always right kind of mentality. I remember years ago, I had a very large customer. And I had dropped the ball two or three times in the period of a month. He had placed large, large orders with my company. This is some 22 years ago. And he got mad. And he just called me up and he canceled three big orders, thousands and thousands of dollars. And I went, oh, please don't do that. Wouldn't take my calls. 2 weeks went by and I couldn't lose the business. So finally, if he wouldn't take my phone calls, I wrote him a one-page letter apologizing, and then promise him I'll never do it again, and I never did. That humiliated me to write that letter. I was humiliated to write a letter begging for his business back and telling him how I was going to fix me, so I never did that to him again. Because he was a high-ranking businessman, and he had to keep his job. He was depending on me, and I let him down. How many people can humiliate themselves to write a letter of apology without accepting the circumstances? You know, I want to apologize for this, but I just want to let you know, you're the one who pressed my buttons and forced me to do it. That's not an apology. There's no humility in that, and you haven't learned anything. All you learned was is how to turn the tables on a person and make it even worse than it was before. And Jesus is saying this, go and reconcile with your brother. Go and reconcile and leave your offering at the altar. Why? Because the issue of the heart, of changing your brother's heart, is more important than your offering. He's saying, it's not saying I don't want your offering or your offering is unnecessary, but your offering is going to prove to be unproductive while you are going out there trashing other people, saying other things, or just making big mistakes in your dealings with people without privately going back and apologizing. And many times, I've seen people not only accept the apology, but break down and cry. I've seen it over and over again. Just cry. Just cry. Because they never had anyone do that to them before. They've never seen anyone come back and apologize for an ought. And this is where we need to be today. We need to learn how to reconcile with our brother. And Jesus says, if you will not do that, you have now committed a sin that's answerable to the court because you haven't corrected it before you got to court. And the court day is coming, friends, where you're going to have to pay a price. Jesus said, you're going to be held accountable for every unprofitable word that you have said. Now, hatreds come from the heart and create all kinds of anguish for other people. Most accusations stem from anger and jealousy, reprisal, or false sense of superiority, or just plain malice. They just want to hurt somebody. And these are, you know, when you're out in the world and people are speaking smack about you, I don't care. But when it comes to church people, and I hear other church people talking about other church people, and I hear about that, I go, how come you have not refrained from getting involved? Don't go to dinner with those people. Don't go out to the bar with those people. Don't go out to lunch with those people. Don't go fishing with them. Don't go kayaking with them. Don't go shopping with them, because they're going to dump some junk down into you that's going to take a lot to get back out of you. And this is where people are in the church today. They'd rather keep their relationships and injure others, which is destroying more relationships, rather than recognizing that they're being used of the devil. All right, so if I forgive you, you've learned nothing, but I've gained prayer power. If you do not reconcile, you've learned nothing again, because you have not suffered the humility of having to apologize. But what happens if you suffer the humility of apologizing? I'll tell you what, your memory improves. You get smart overnight. You might have only had two brain cells talking to one another previously, and now you got the whole brain working. And you know why? Because you do not want to have to go through that conviction and then bringing yourself to say, I did this a second time, and go apologize to that same person or another person. I had a guy call me up on the phone, I don't know, 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And he said, you said such and such about my company. I go, yeah, I did. I did. Well, I need to talk to you about that. I said, well, I apologize. It came out wrong. I said it in the wrong context. And will you forgive me? I did it wrong. You know, I took the fire right out of that man. We became friends after that. You know why? Because people need to learn how to apologize, because we all make mistakes with our words. Right. We all do. And some of us more than others. And ladies, you got to be careful about some of those women that just act spiritual and don't want to do a spiritual takedown on someone else. That injures people. That wounds people. And now you have a personal responsibility. Even if you nodded your head and was in agreement, you now have a reason to go and reconcile with your brother or your sister. But if I forgive you and you also reconcile, you've learned how to better treat your neighbor, and also you've earned forgiveness of your neighbor and of the court. There is going to be a court. There is a court date coming. So people that say, well, they're just Christian, they need to forgive me, they haven't learned anything. They're demanding an act of Christianity on the person that they have gone out of their way to offend, but they're not doing anything to reconcile and fix this inherent problem in their own spiritual nature. They haven't done anything. They haven't fixed anything. I've apologized to my wife a lot. She's apologized a lot to me. I've apologized to my children. In fact, recently, I don't know if this was about 6 weeks ago, I got really angry with one of my kids, and then like 5 or 10 minutes later, I got back on the phone and go, I'm sorry, I was angry. I handled that wrong. That's humiliating. And I have 8 children. I can make 8 mistakes just in that one area alone. But people don't know how to do this. They lie, they don't repent. And some people don't care. I was asking God last night, how is this message going to go over today? You know what he spoke to me? He said, you can't change the world. And not everyone is going to hear this. What? There are some people that are unchangeable. They will not change. They're stubborn. So I'm not preaching to them. I'm preaching to you that have an open heart. To want to learn how to walk in God. Amen. Go with me over to Mark 11. Mark chapter 11. And let's just go down to verse 25. And whenever you stand praying, forgive if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father who is in heaven will also forgive you your transgressions. Or put another way, if you have an ought against your brother, you're also to forgive. You're to reconcile your feelings towards that individual and let it go. Now, reconciliation causes great things to happen to you. Look what happens. In verse 25, so that your Father in heaven will also forgive you your transgressions. So now you have prayer power. But verse 26, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father who is in heaven forgive you your transgressions, which are greater than the one transgression that you're holding out on forgiving. All the things that you've done wrong are extremely numerous, and whatever your neighbor did to you is very narrow in scope comparably. If you want God to forgive you of all your stuff, you got to forgive that one puddlehead over here of that one particular thing. Right. Are you with me? That's all you got to do. But now you have to do it repeatedly whenever it comes up. So what are we seeing here? First, you forgive your brother, right? The second thing that I noticed here is apologizing is not only an art form, it is an art form, but it's a lost art form. I'm going to show you how to apologize and how to reconcile here in a little bit. But what Jesus is saying through all this stuff, religion and religious exercise is lost on God when you are in dissension and malice with your Christian brother or sister. If you've created dissension, if you created friction, and you are the cause of it, your spirituality, your religious exercise is completely lost on God. And in fact, He has a completely different viewpoint of your religious exercise. You're not being religious like you should. Now, go with me over to 1 Peter chapter 3. Let's start in verse 8. To sum up, all of you, be harmonious, sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, and humble in spirit, not returning evil for evil or insult for insult, but giving a blessing instead. For you were called for this very purpose, that you might inherit a blessing. For the one who desires life and to see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Do you see this? I want you to see the bigger picture. This is not just a New Testament command. This is not something Jesus dreamed up for the first time that we've been only following as humankind for the last 2,000 years. But actually, again, now we see this is all in caps quoting the Old Testament. In fact, quoting the Psalms. We're seeing here that Peter is writing this. The one who desires life to love and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Do you see how big this is? This is heart murder that he's saying, stop practicing. And it was a big enough deal back 2,000 years ago that he wrote about it. It's still a big deal today. Because people say things about other people, sometimes wrongly. Sometimes we get angry. But if we don't reconcile, there is no way that you are going to stop this behavior from continuing in the future. In fact, there'll come a place where you'll get so hard-hearted, you'll say, I haven't done anything wrong. What do you complain about? I mean, it's just saying the truth. The Holy Spirit told me to say that. Really? The Holy Spirit told you to badmouth somebody? The Holy Spirit is never going to have you violate His very word. He's never going to talk you into it. And many times people say the Holy Spirit said to do this, or told them to do that, or said to make a comment about someone, when the Holy Spirit does not sow discord amongst the brethren. The Holy Spirit does not do that. And when you want to blame it on the Holy Spirit, you are literally blaspheming God. Blaming the Holy Spirit, who can't protect himself, for something he never said and something he never did. And Jesus talked about that warning. That's a message for another day. Amen. So, evil is defined here more than actions. It is evil intent, evil words that wrong others. Let's keep reading. Verse 11, he must turn away from evil and do good. He must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord, the eyes of Yahweh are toward the righteous, and his ears attend to their prayer. But the face of Yahweh is against those who do evil. What is the doing of evil? This is not adultery. It's not even murder or theft. It is heart murder with your words. That's the discussion here. It is talking about the tongue. It's not talking about other actions. So evil is defined more than actions. It is evil intent, evil words that wrong others. In Isaiah 5, it says this, woe to them who call evil good and good evil. Many times people in the church will call things that are good evil because they are not in agreement with it, because it treads on their sensibilities. Our liberal, Christian, 21st century sensibilities. It treads all over them. Oh, you can't say that. You can't do that. Don't you know you're going to hurt someone's feelings? Really? Right? When did we look at the Bible and say, we're going to believe this, we're going to obey it as long as it doesn't hurt our feelings? Does anyone remember where we're supposed to read? If someone could send me that verse, I'd like to get reprimanded on that area. The Bible doesn't tell us we follow the Word of God because we agree with it. It tells us to follow the Word of God to order our lives. And sometimes we're not going to agree with it. Amen. We're not going to agree with it. We're not going to like it. What are those who call evil good and good evil? Many people have picked fights because the person was more righteous than them. They just picked a fight. I don't like their growth. I don't like the fact that they were right. They just picked a fight. The humility of reconciliation does two things. It produces a change in heart in you. And secondarily, it demonstrates your humanity. Got any people that are human here? You know, the more I've apologized to people, only in a few instances have people made fun of me. And I'll tell you what, the people that made fun of me are in church. They're not in the world. I've gone and apologized to non-Christians repeatedly that did business with me and apologized. You know what I get? I drive away and they're texting me already. I've never had anyone apologize to me. I've never had anyone tell me they were wrong and I was right. And you know what that's doing? They know I'm a pastor. They know I'm on TV. You know what it does? It invites them to become a Christian. It lets them know that all Christians are human. It shows them their humanity. In fact, in my opinion, someone that apologizes has a bigger backbone, a stronger backbone than those that don't. But a lot of people think that, well, if I apologize, then someone's going to make fun of me. Well, that's the risk you're going to have to take if you created an ought in your brother against you. You're the one who started this fight. You're the one who needs to end it. And the best way to end it is with an apology. An apology. Now here, I'm going to give you some rules for apologizing. Y'all ready? Okay. Here's the rules for apologizing. If you're going to reconcile with a friend after a fight or after you've done something wrong or you've been found out for saying something wrong about them, decide to be humble and approach your friend. It could be a text message. It could be an email. It could be a phone call. But you let them know you want an appointment. That's all you want. You don't apologize on the phone. You don't apologize in a text message. You don't apologize by email. Ladies, you especially, get face to face. All you women that apologize and you've been doing it by text message, that is not the proper way. Second thing is set an appointment, and not an appointment over food, not an appointment at a ladies' meeting or at a men's meeting. Don't have it at a restaurant, right? There is no time. See, you know what? Eating, according to God's word, is supposed to be a festival. If you got bad news to deliver or you have something bad to do or bad for you to do, you don't have it over food. You don't even have it over coffee. You have a face-to-face, no coffee, just a glass of water on each side, and that's it. And you keep it to just a meeting. Don't manipulate the person. Plan on going in there, not to manipulate them, to show anything wrong with them, but you just say, I'm sorry, and you leave it to that. Now watch this. Have the apology come first. This is number three. Have the apology come first and keep to the task of not arguing. If they say, well, yeah, you know, this is like the 15th time you did it, shut up. If it is the 15th time, or, you know, well, I only did it 14 times. You know how Midwesterners argue, don't you? We change the subject. So yeah, you did that 15 times and then you want to argue. Well, no, I only did it 14 times. The 15th time you started it. Well, now you're getting way off. Just shut up. Apologize, reconcile, say you did wrong, and take the brunt of whatever. And plan before you get there for the devil to try to get you to open your mouth and button it. Just be quiet. Next thing, don't ask for apology or forgiveness. Generally, that doesn't work. And keep the meeting short and then get up and leave. 5-minute meeting. Don't sit there and try to talk about the weather and the kids. Just get up and leave. Apologize face to face, get up and leave. Thank you very much. I just needed to get that off my heart. And then finally, number 5, give the person that you're reconciling with time to think about it and time to change, particularly if they've got as wicked of a tongue as you have. They might need time to change. They might not ever change. In which case, then you're going to need to separate. But give it proper time to have its proper effect. 2 closing scriptures. We're going to deal with them quickly. Proverbs 17. Let's go there. Proverbs 17, verse 13. He who returns evil for good, or he who repays evil for good, evil will not depart from his house. Many times people do us good. In 50% of the time where I have overseen money being given away, or cars being given away, or property being given away, or bills being paid, 50% of the time, not over 50%, maybe not under 50%, but 50% of the time, I've seen the people that gave that money away or gave that car away, when I, particularly if I was in the middle of it trying to help massage, putting it together and getting everything done, 50% of the time, I've seen the person that gave the car away, gave the money away, get abused later on by the receiver of that car or that money. It's a shame. And these are church people. Get abused. Well, the car doesn't run that good. Really? You just got a car. You didn't have a car, and now you're abusing the person that gave it to you. I've seen people's bills get paid. A lot of bills get paid. And then turn around and see that person who paid their bills get abused. And they do it in a spiritual context. Well, they just want something out of God. What? What? Now you're attacking that person's spirituality? They had a motive? By the way, anyone who gives anything away has a motive. They're honoring God. Amen. So there's a motive. Anyone who returns evil for good, evil shall never leave their home. Be careful that you do not violate when someone does you a favor. Be very, very careful. This goes right back to heart murder. And why did Cain murder his brother? Because, and the Bible tells us, New Testament tells us, because his deeds were more righteous than his own. And it is the many times when people are more righteous than us, then we want to tear them down. Finally, I'm going to close it here in Mark chapter 12. Start up in verse 28. One of the scribes came and heard them arguing, and recognizing that he had answered them well, asked him, or asked Jesus, what commandment is the foremost of all? Or what is the greatest commandment? We know that we call this the greatest commandment. Jesus answered, the foremost is, and this comes from the Old Testament again, it's in Hebrew, in the Old Testament, Shema Yisrael, or Hear, O Israel. The Lord our God is one Lord, or the Lord our God is, or Yahweh is God, Yahweh is one. That's really what it says in the Old Testament. Yahweh is God. In other words, being very specific about who the real true God is, and Yahweh is one. He's one God. In verse 30, now he changes it. The second is this one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and all your strength. All right? So that's the first and the greatest commandment. The second greatest commandment is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. And the scribe said to him, right, teacher, you have truly stated he is one and there's no else beside him. And to love with all the heart and with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one neighbor's as himself is as much as all the burnt offerings and sacrifices. So we see here again that to love a neighbor is greater than sacrifice. It's not to replace sacrifice. God wants our sacrifice, but he wants us to love our neighbor. I'm going to close it with this illustration. I'm going to read you from the New Testament commentary. Y'all ready? This is kind of funny. The golden rule can be found in Jewish writings. This is the Jewish New Testament commentary. The golden rule can be found in Jewish writings as early as the apocryphal book of Tobit. What you hate, do to no one, Tobit 4:15. Similar sayings are attributed to different writers. Rabbi Hillel is one of them. Expressed it in the generation before Yeshua, the famous passage in the Talmud comparing Hillel with his contemporary Shammai tells the story. Here's the story. A pagan came before Shammai and said to him, "Make me a proselyte of Judaism, but on one condition, that you teach me the entire Torah while I'm standing on one foot." Shammai drove him off with the building's measuring rod that he had in his hand. He had a big stick, a measuring rod in his hand, and Shammai, who was a great rabbi, even considered by today's standards, drove him off with the stick, saying, "That's a ridiculous request." Right? So when he appeared before Hillel, his teacher, who also is a great rabbi, later told him, "What is hateful to you, do not do to your neighbor." That is the whole Torah. The rest is commentary. Go and learn it. So this is what the greater rabbi said. He said this: the whole Torah is commentary, but to sum up the whole Torah is this: what is hateful to you, do not do to your neighbor. Watch this. I got a book in my hand. I'm near the edge. What is hateful to you, do not do to your neighbor. That's the whole Old Testament in a nutshell. Amen. Give God the glory here this morning. Hallelujah. Let's all stand. Let's all stand. Let's pray this morning. Dear Father Yahweh Elohim, we thank you for your word here today. We give you praise and honor and glory. Father, I ask right now that you would move on the hearts of people to this week to consider, Father God, reconciling with their spouses, with their children, with others, Father, that they have offended, maybe at work or maybe here in this church. And Father, that they would reconcile and recognize that the humility produces a visual humanity for other people to see. I thank you, Father, right now for your word here today. Father, we ask for forgiveness and the things that we've done wrong. Teach us how to walk according to your word and according to this challenge that's been laid down before all of us here today. We give you praise and we give you glory and we give you honor in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, you ready for a blessing? All right, get ready. Yahweh bless you and protect you. Yahweh deal kindly and graciously with you. Yahweh bestow his favor upon you and grant you shalom. So shall they link my name with the people, and then I will bless them. Give the Lord a shout here today. Amen. You know, Kathy, one of the greatest decisions a person can ever make in their lifetime is to receive Jesus Christ Amen. As their personal Lord and Savior.
Yes, it is.
I want you to do that. You know that you want to do that. And of course, God wants you to give your heart to Jesus Christ, his only yes. beloved Son. And if you'd like to do that right now, you can do that while you're watching television here this yes. morning. Just repeat these words after me, and Kathy will say them along with you. Say, "Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Come into my heart right now.
Come into my heart right now.
And make me a new person.
And make me a new person.
A new creation.
I don't want to be
that old person anymore.
That old person anymore.
Thank you, Jesus. For dying on the cross for me. So that I don't have to die. For all the things that I've done wrong. In Jesus' name. Amen. You know, if you just gave your heart to Jesus Christ, it was the greatest decision yes. you ever made in your entire life. And it's going to make sure that you get to heaven. All your sins have been washed away. In fact, Kathy, the Bible says that the angels rejoice.
Yes, they do.
Over one sinner that repents.
Yes, they do.
There's a party going on in heaven. And if you just gave your heart to Jesus Christ right now, we want to hear from you. Write us here at P.O. Box 847, Lake Delton, Wisconsin, 52940. And we want to put materials into your hand to have you start out your brand new walk with God.